Hello, everybody. I'm happy being your chair for the next presentation today. And during this presentation, please write down all your questions in the chat window and prefix them with a Q, as you're used to from the former presentations. I would like to welcome Andreas von Bechtolsheim today. He is a German electrical engineer by trade, entrepreneur, and investor. He is the founder of Sun, the inventor of the Sun workstation, and also one of the earliest Google investors. In 2005, he launched the company he's representing today, Arista, where he serves as the chairman of the board and chief development officer. Undisputedly, Andreas has massively influenced the community and industry we are all working in. Today, we're excited to have him here at DENOG12 with a presentation about next generation optics for data center access and long haul. Andreas, the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you for your kind introduction. So I'm not going to talk about switching and routing here, but really just focus on optics. This is actually a topic I have spent a lot of my time on lately, because there's just a lot of new things happening that I want to cover today. But before I get into the optics, I just have to branch out a little bit into Moore's law and what's going to happen on the high-speed electrical signaling known as the CERDIS I/O. So starting off with Moore's law, here's Dr. Gordon Moore as a young person in 1966 when he looked through the microscope and he discovered Moore's law. And the original version was it would double every year, but the version that was the official version in 1973, it was going to double the transistor count on the chip every 2 years. And this has been going like a steady curve for the last 40 years and counting. And the latest chips that have been built are pushing 40 billion transistors, which is really an amazing number. Now, there's been a lot of talk that Moore's law is hitting a wall. And this talk actually started a couple of years ago. Partially because I think Intel had some trouble with their process development. But the reality is that 5-nanometer technology is actually in volume production. The new iPhone ARM CPU chip is in 5-nanometer, and they're going to make like 100 million chips this quarter. And the 3-nanometer tapeouts are starting to happen next year for products shipping in 22. So the roadmap to 3-nanometer is actually very well defined, and people have started to work on the generation beyond this known as 2.1. In fact, some of the roadmap goes out all the way to 0.7-nanometer, if you can believe this. So Moore's law is definitely not dead at all. It is just getting more expensive, you know, to put up these factories. There's only two companies in the whole world that make 5-nanometer chips, which is Samsung and TSMC. And it's an extremely expensive sort of effort to stay ahead on this race. Now, the way this relates to switching and routing is that with denser processes, we obviously get more and more transistors per chip at a lower power and at a higher speed. And this has enabled the switching chips and the routing chips to roughly double the speed per chip every 2 years, which is actually a little ahead of Moore's law. And there's an explanation which we'll see in a second. Talking about the routing chips, which may be of particular interest here, the Cherisher 2 chip, which is the basis of our routing products, supports 4800 gigabits per chip or 1200 gig chips, ports per chip. This is almost 5 times more than the previous generation Cherisher 1 Plus chip. And Cherisher 2 C Plus, which is an announced part and it's in the lab, improves that performance by another 50%. And Cherisher 3, which is expected in about 2 years from now, is expected to double that. Now, the reason there has been such a rapid progress on the networking side is actually a little different, which is historically, these chips used what we call legacy, meaning older processes that were cheaper to manufacture, but obviously much slower. So until the current Cherisher 2 chip, which is still in 16-nanometer, all the prior chips were actually 28-nanometer. This is a technology Intel was shipping in 2011, so it's really quite obsolete by now. And it's only the next generation Cheshire 2C Plus chip that is in 7 nanometer, where it's kind of catching up with the CPU roadmap, although that will have moved on to 5 nanometer. So the point of this is because networking chips were so far behind in process technology, the progress actually has been more rapid as they're adopting the latest processes. And to illustrate how important these improvements are, the improvement from 16 nanometer normalized to 1, to 7, to 5, the density goes up, you know, 3.3 going to 5 times. The speed at the same power improves 30 to 50%, or the power at the same speed declines by roughly half. So the key message here is that with each new process generation, we get, you know, more performance, more transistors, bigger tables, more buffers, all the things that are good for networking. There's only one wrinkle in the ointment, and that is the design cost for these denser, more advanced process chips is going literally through the roof. This chart here is an estimate of design costs for an Intel class x86 types processor chip. Networking chips are a little easier to design because there are a lot of step and repeat functions. Basically, in the networking chip, all the ports are the same, and you know there's just a lot less complexity than a full CPU. But in terms of relative numbers, it still applies, which is the mass cost, otherwise known as the tape-out cost of a 7 nanometer chip, is roughly $10 million for the mask set. Just to get the CAD tools that you need to tape out this chip, to rent these tools for a year, cost another $10 million. And by the time you have a whole design team designing a chip and verifying it, you're looking at an annual cost of roughly $50 million to design a chip these days, no matter what the complexity is. So chip design is exceedingly expensive, and it's getting more expensive as these technologies get more advanced. The implication of this is that the only business model that's viable here, in our opinion, is merchant silicon, because you need to amortize these design costs in volume. And as a result, at least our forecast is there will be fewer rather than more chip architectures in the future for switches, routers, and optics. This is a little history of merchant silicon. A little over 10 years ago, the very first merchant chip that we used to build a 24-port 10 gig data center switch was literally the first data center class chip on the market. Since we have obviously merchant silicon for switching, routing, and the DSPs for the optical transport, which we'll cover in a minute. But the long and short here is that the traditional way of building routers, which relied on custom designs by the routing companies, is sort of falling by the wayside because the merchant silicon chips have just taken over the market. And this had to do with the rapid innovation in merchant silicon, where literally every year there was a new chip with more throughput, more performance, more ports, more buffers, more routing entries than the previous year. So the products in this space have been rapidly improving with both Moore's law and each generation of merchant silicon. And if you think about it, you know, the fundamental reason why merchant silicon is winning has just been time to market and the rapid improvement in those chips. The only reason to build a custom chip would be to add some proprietary custom features, which in industry standard, networking, ITF style networking, you really don't want proprietary features. But the bottom line is just volume economics. The entire market for networking chips isn't actually that big. It's measured in the hundred thousands of chips per year. And it's very, very hard to get a return on investment with proprietary designs. So switching now over to the roadmap on the electrical side before we get to the optics. One of the key reasons for the rapid improvements in the throughput is the speed of the electrical lanes, because on each chip, you can have only so many pins on the package, and you can only have so many channels coming out of the chip. So as the industry progressed from, say, 10 gigabits per second 10 years ago to 25 gigabits, which was launched in 2015, to the more recently 50 gigabits launched last calendar year, the throughput per chip for the same package size literally, you know, doubled or quintupled since the 10 years ago. the next generation, in fact, all future silicon chips that are not yet taped out, all the stuff that's still in the on the drawing board and coming out starting next year, is all 100 gigabit SerDes. And that is going to be the standard for a while because it's very difficult to go faster than 100 gigabit. But the point of this is that with 100 gigabit, a single channel, of course, you get a full 100 gigabit Ethernet. With four channels, you get a 400 gig port. And with eight channels, you can build an 800 gig Ethernet port. So this has, again, allowed the industry to make this rapid improvement in density. And if one looks at the projections of bandwidth shipped as a function of SerDes speed, the dark blue color here is the 100 gigabit SerDes that is showing up kind of very late this calendar year, but really in, I'm sorry, it's in the lab this calendar year, but showing up in any kind of volume next year, entering more significant volume in 22. By 23, it is projected that the 100 gigabit SerDes chips, these are the switch and routing chips, will have more bandwidth than the entire market in 22, which is kind of hard to believe, but the forecast is for very, very rapid adoption. And clearly this is because those silicons are better and more cost-effective than the previous generations. In the green color on the upper right, there's some forecast already for 200 gigabit SerDes coming in late 24, 25, but there's various challenges with 200 gig, which we'll cover in a minute. That means the adoption of that will be much slower. Now, to summarize the SerDes thing here, so again, we're still shipping a lot of 25 gig for the legacy silicon, and 100 gigabit optics today are largely 4x25, CWM4 or PSM4, four channels of 25. But as the industry is moving to 100 gigabit SerDes, the optics that use 100 gig lambda per channel are the ideal choice because any other optics requires what's known as gearboxes to convert from, say, 100 gig electrical channel to 4x25 or vice versa, which adds a lot of cost, quite frankly, and power, and is thus undesirable. And the 100 gig SerDes are expected to have an extremely long life and extremely high volume, with the marketing forecast of 1 billion channels shipped between 2021 through 2031 for 10 years. So this is a very, very high market opportunity and obviously a lot of investment going into this. So the good thing about 100 gig SerDes is we get much denser optics. So there will be 100 gig SFP. This is the same SFP that today is at 25 gigabit, used to be 10 gigabit. There is emerging 50 gigabit SFP, but not too much interest in that, but there is a lot of interest in getting a 100 gigabit optical connection down to an SFP size. And this will be available in all the single mode, multi-mode, DR, ER, LR, SR kind of variants. The good old QSFP, which today is primarily 100 gigabit, 4x25, will become a 400 gig QSFP. So it's not QSFP-DD, this is just QSFP four lanes of 100 gig SerDes driving four lanes of 100 gig lambda. And this will be fully compatible with the legacy QSFPs without wasting any switch lanes. And then the eight lane form factors known as OSFP and QSFP-DD will support with eight electrical channels, eight lanes of 100 gig lambda or 800 gig optics. And this will be the highest density, both the highest density and the lowest cost per bit. So this is another way of looking at this, which is as these SerDes speeds have increased from the 10 gigabit to 25 to 100 gig, 50 and the 100 gigabit now, the modules, of course, are able to go faster in each year. And we actually have the first 800 gig OSFP samples in the lab now that are believed to be in full production in less than a year from now. Now switching to the true optics roadmap, the topic of my talk, the way to think about optics is there's no single solution for all distances. And for example, multimode, goes 100 meter or so over multimode fiber, not that interesting for service providers. Data center optics tend to go 2 kilometers, maximum size of a very large cloud data center. Longer reach optics up to 10 kilometers, the extra long reach up to 40 kilometer, and then the DWM kind of optics, which can go 1,000 kilometers and more. So for each speed, 100 gigabit, 400 gig, 800 gig, there will be different optics matching these technologies and these reaches. So the SR in the 100 gig SerDes environment will go up to 100 meters. At least that's the, this hasn't shipped yet, but that's the goal of the IEEE spec on OM4. The DR spec, which is complete, 2 kilometers, and this is 100 gig DR, 400 gig DR4, 800 gig DR8. The LR specs will go, they're really going 10 kilometers. There's a little debate between the IEEE. Under worst case conditions, it may only be 6 or 8 kilometers, but on all practical good fibers, they will go 10 kilometers. And then the extra reach specs will go perhaps up to 40, maybe it's 30, but call it 30 to 40 kilometers. And there will be ER, ER4, and ER8. And then beyond this, you have the high order modulation, 16 QAM kind of optics, 400 gig CR, and future 800 gig CR. So except for that CR, CR plus, everything on this list is 100 gig lambda optics. I have the same data here in a different format, which is, if one thinks about next generation 100 gig data center optic standards using primarily the 100 gig PAM4 lambda coding, there will be everything from SR on the bottom to DR, LR, ER, and also BiDi, by the way. So BiDi will enable the same reach as 100 gig ER over single mode fiber, which saves on fibers, that's again in the lab. For 400 gig, it's the same kind of list. There's SR4, DR4, FR4, LR4, ER4 coming out, and ZR. And then for the future 800 gig optics, the same list again, SR8, DR8. There will also be dual 400 gig FR4 in, or LR4 in one module, because the 800 gig Ethernet isn't quite ready yet. So people will use 800 gig optics primarily to output dual 400 gig or 800 gigs for that matter, and 800 gig DR8. But people are already working on FR8, LR8, and ER8 as well. So there's a lot of new optics, all based on the 100 gig lambda optical engines, as well as the high order modulations for the longer reach. And the reason there's so much interest in these 800 gig optics, quite frankly, is cost. So the current forecast or prediction is that 800 gig optics compared to current 400 gig modules, the 400 gig modules are 8x50, the 800 gig is 8x100, will be between 1/3 to 40% lower cost per bit. And the reason is very simple, which is in the 400 gig module, there is the most expensive part is the so-called DSP chip that converts 8x50 PAM4 to 4x100, especially a fancy gearbox. Whereas in the 800 gig optics, there's just one of these chips. So in the 400 gig, you need two chips, one for each 400 gig. The other one is one chip. It's the same cost for that chip, but you save one full chip, and that makes it 1/3 less costly. There's additional cost saving at the system level. One can build smaller boxes with fewer, module connectors, fewer PC boards, and so on. And the other advantage of 800 gig form factor is you can still plug in 400 gig CR or any 400 gig optics and get 400 gig out of the same plug. So that works as well. And again, the 800 gig haven't shipped yet, but all the leading vendors in silicon photonics, including Intel, distributors from Intel, are predicting this roughly one third cost per bit reduction from the four lanes over here to the eight lanes. And in fact, if there was a 16 lane module, it would even be a little bit cheaper yet, but there's no industry standard 16 lane or 32 channel modules at this point. Now, what this means is that a future Tomahawk 5 chip, which is 51.2 terabit in 2023 with 100 gig SerDes, can be built in a 2U box with 64 800 gig OSFPs. It would look something like this. This is actually a picture of our current 25.6T switch with 64 400 gig OSFP, but it's the same picture for the next generation. So this actually supports up to 128 400 gig ports, FR4, LR4, DR4 in a 2U box without any co-packaged optics required. And we think this will be a very cost-effective product. Now, things of course get even more interesting if there's a real 800 gig Ethernet MAC in the box. Tomahawk 5, as well as Jersey 3 will have 800 gig Ethernet MACs. the spec was completed. There's a little disconnect here. The Ethernet Geek Ethernet spec was actually completed in April this year by the Ethernet Technology Alliance, which is the same group of companies, including Microsoft and Broadcom and Cisco and Aristos in there, that brought you the 25 gig Ethernet, which they actually didn't want to do 5 years ago. They changed the name to Ethernet Technology Alliance. So they wrote the Ethernet Geek spec and it's done. And this is what's being implemented in silicon now. The IEEE just issued a call for action to start an Ethernet Geek or future Ethernet Geek speed something Ethernet effort, which will take at least 4 years. So in this case, the chips will ship 2 years before the IEEE spec is completed. But the bottom line is the IEEE process is so slow that the industry couldn't wait for the IEEE to get its act together. And as a result, you know, there will be both switches, routers, and optics that will be in production, we believe, in 2023. And it's also the first time in history that the Ethernet Geek optics will actually be ready before the Ethernet Geek Mac, because they will be used on previous generation systems that don't yet support the Ethernet Geek Ethernet Mac, but the dual 400 gig. So this raises the next topic, which is, you know, with all these new optics, how are they interoperable with existing optics investments? People have purchased, you know, millions, actually 10 of millions of 100 gig optics, 25 gig optics, 40 gig optics, you know, all these different optics. And interoperability is best thought of at three different levels. One is at the purely at the optical level. Obviously, if to interoperate the optics from one equipment has to match the other equipment, that's a given. Then at the physical level, it's nice if there's compatible form factors where one can plug in the next generation or a previous generation, the next generation plug. And finally, there's even concerns at the fiber connector level. People have millions and, you know, tens of millions of LC connectors in the world. Some of the newer optics need denser connectors, and that's not really compatible. So there's efforts to address this as well. So starting with optical interoperability across optics form factors, because remember, it's not the form factor that defines the optical interoperability, it's what's on the fiber, of course. So as an example here, the first generation QSFP 100 gig DR. So these are the single lambda 100 gig optics, which are available now in the QSFP form factor. They actually have to have a little gearbox inside to convert the 4x25 gig electrical channels into the single channel 100 gig. But they will be fully interoperable, of course, with future SFP 100 gig DR that have a 100 gig electrical channel and output 100 gig DR on the optical side, because it's the same optics. And the SFP will be significantly lower power and lower cost than the first generation QSFP, but they both can talk to each other. Another example of this is on the 400 gig optics. The industry actually made a little mistake here. The first generation 400 gig optics were phase lock loop linked to just the 400 gig speed. They could not support other speeds. The newer ones coming out now are so-called multi-speed 400 gig optics. And FR4 has the same wavelength plan as 100 gig C11-4 or 200 gig FR4. So in software, you can actually change the speed of a 400 gig FR4 port to talk to a 200 gig FR4 or even 100 gig C11-4 without changing the optics or anything else. And that's convenient because you don't have to upgrade both sides of the link at the same time. So all the future multi-speed 400 gig FR4 optics, as well as DR4 optics, will have this capability, which was a major oversight on the first generation gearboxes. Now, another popular thing to do is to take a 400 gig DR4, which has, you can configure the port to be 400 gig ports and simply break it out to four individual 100 gig ports. A lot of people don't like the spaghetti splitter fiber cables that go from LC connector to MTP, MPO. So there's new connectors known as either the SN or the MDC connector. They kind of do the same thing, but they're not identical. One is from a Japanese company called consortium called Senyu Denki, and the other one from Corning. But they do allow to put four of these on a single OSFP or QSFP-DD. And the result is you can have duplex fiber, individual duplex fiber patch cable for each 100 gig circuit, and it avoids the need for the MPO-MTP splitter cable. In fact, for the future Ethernet geek, there's another problem, which is a lot of people like the LC connectors. And on the OSFP, there's actually the physical room to support a dual LC connector on the front surface. So a future dual 400 gig FR4 module can actually support the regular LC connector, which is by far the most popular in the industry. And this is just a slide to summarize all these different breakout options. So starting with the 400 gig world, the most common use of 400 gig today, quite honestly, is breakout either as 2x200. This is what Google is doing in their data centers, or 400 gig DR4 breaking out to 400 gig, which is what Amazon is doing in their data center. So the bulk of 400 gig ports today are actually not used in a native 400 gig mode, but really as a dual 200 gig or 4x100 gig mode. The 400 gig SR4 isn't quite shipping yet, but this will also be, I think, very popular with 100 gig SR modules, because 100 gig SR, of course, is duplex multimode LC connector. You don't need the parallel multimode fiber for that. So to sum this all up here, for the data center optics, and we're getting to the longer reach in just 1 minute, basically all future silicon will have 100 gig SerDes. Every single chip that's coming is 100 gig SerDes, which is directly compatible with 100 gig lambda optics. And even though the installed base of optics is primarily 25 gig lambda today, 25 gig NRC, it will be a long but predictable transition to 100 gig lambda, because for the next 10 years, you know, that's the highest volume electrical and also the lowest cost optical interface going forward. This enables these new form factors we talked about, 100 gig SFP, 400 gig QSFP, and the 800 gig OSFP or QSFP-DD. And the other key message here is that multi-speed optics are and will be backwards compatible with the lower speed grades, in particular the very large installed base of 100 gig CW4 that will talk to the 400 gig FR4. And there is early discussion on 200 gig SerDes and 200 gig optics. So people have started to look at this. What is clear is that 200 gig is electrically and optically extremely challenging. It will require new forward error correction, and it usually takes a while for people to agree on that. A whole new optics ecosystem. The optics people are all busy working on the 100 gig lambda optics, so they're not going. Nobody's paying a lot of attention to this right now, because none of this is specified, so you can't actually build the product yet. But there's early efforts to both at the OIF and at the IEEE to look at the best solution for coding and forward error correction. One of the initial goals is to enable 800 gig optics with 4 200 gig lambda. So this would be an 800 gig module that is still 800 gig SerDes electrical lanes coming in, but 4 lambda 200 gig optics going out, having a gearbox inside the module. And it is projected that those modules will be lower cost than 800 gig DR8 or dual 400 gig FR4, because it's fewer lasers and less optics. It is expected that the first samples of such modules is available in 2024. But the key observation is that these 200 gig lambda optics are really tied to the adoption of 800 gig Ethernet, which is a single channel 800 gig for 200 gig lambda. I would expect that the 400 gig Ethernet will remain with 100 gig lambda optics, just in terms of the installed base and the momentum of the installed base, through the life cycle of 400 gig. So in other words, I don't expect the dual 200 gig channel suddenly cornering the market for 400 gig. The long and short of this is that the 800 gig market will start happening in 2024 with the silicon, but is it a much slower ramp than the 400 gig market, which is, going to be very high volume at that point. So the projected opportunity for 200 gig lambda optics is a fraction of the 100 gig lambda optics over the next 10 years. Now let's switch topics and get back to the extended reach, anything beyond data center reach, anything beyond 10 kilometer. And I should say up front, there are really two different buckets here, that and one bucket didn't get a lot of attention until recently. So the first bucket, which is the 10 to 40 kilometer bucket, let me cover that first before we get to the 400 gig CR. So one thing about 100 gig ER, which we have mentioned earlier, this is the 100 gig lambda optics, is you can actually do it in a, not quite a DWM, but sort of not either more like a LAN grid or maybe a nanometer, 2 nanometer kind of grid, call it a 400 gigahertz grid. You can get up to 8 channels into one fiber. So you can actually passively mux together 800 gig ER channels with different, you know, frequencies into one 800 gig ER8 module. And that is pretty neat because you can reach 30 to 40 kilometers and it's all passive. There's no amplifier needed, no optical line systems, and it's just really easy to deploy and low cost. But for anything else, you know, either if you want more bandwidth per fiber or you need longer reach, it's going to be 400 gig CR, CR plus, CR plus plus all the way, which enable on a 75 gigahertz grid up to 64 channels per fiber in the C band alone is 25.6 terabits per fiber, 100 kilometer plus reach. And of course you need an external amplification and line system. So those are sort of the broad buckets. Now you can always deploy, you know, ZR, call it ZR minus at 10 to 40 kilometer reach, but it's gonna be more expensive than ER for that application. So, but focusing in on this ER for a second. So again, the specs of this were just proposed at the 100 gig lambda consortium literally 4 weeks ago. So you may not have heard about this yet, but the realization has been, or is, that 400 gig CR, as attractive as it is actually overkill for these sort of access links that go from a 5G cell tower to the central office or from a commercial customer to the internet exchange point, right? So for these links that traditionally have used ER type optics, there's a way to go faster, in particular 100 gig ER. And you can deploy these things without any amplification, and it's just much simpler and more reliable and lower power. So I tried to draw a picture here of a theoretical use case, which is eight either customers or cell towers or, you know, tenants in a high-res building that all want their own 100 gigabit circuit to a service provider. You can mux them together, you know, in the base of the building and carry it up to, it may be 30 to 40 kilometer reach over one pair of fibers. And on the other side, you can actually terminate this into a single 800 gig ER8 module, because that module internally has the same inverse mux, the mux demux. And of course you can configure that port as individual 100 gig services. So one can essentially aggregate 800 gig channels very cost effectively in the access case into one routing port on the next generation router. And anything else, and if you try to do this with 400 gig CR, you would require a field aggregation router, meaning an active device in the bottom of that cell tower or in the bottom of that building that performs the routing function, which is a lot more expensive than a passive mux. So that's the kind of one use case. In terms of productization, the 100 gig ER in the QSFP form factor will be the first product out. There's samples available now. And then again, you can put up to 8 of these through one duplex fiber, or I should mention, you can put up to 4 of them over a single BiDi fiber. So this will also support BiDi, meaning single fiber in a BiDi mode. The next product will be a 400 gig ER4 in the current 8x50 gigabit OSFP and QSFP-DD form factor. And then the third product in about 2 years from now will be 800 gig ER8 that aggregates 8 of these into one module. So that's the roadmap there. The specs have been published at the 100 gig lambda consortium. Again, this is still in the debate, but just to highlight one spec here, the power for this, 3.5 watts, right, for 100 gig module. And this includes the gearbox that it needs to output to convert the 4x25 into the 1x100. So this is all mature technology. It's, you know, EML laser, germanium silicon, APD, and just a strong equalizer. All of this has been built and is ready to ramp next year. To compare this to ZR for a second, so yes, one could use ER ZR in the same use case, but it's probably twice the power and roughly twice the cost. On these standards meetings, they can't discuss absolute cost. So the dollar signs here is simply the complexity of these various components, and then they add up, you know, the total dollars here, but there's $19 here and there's $9 here. So it's roughly twice the cost. Again, to position this correctly, right, it's for the access case where you're fiber rich and you don't need more than 800 gigabits per fiber for duplex fiber. If you need more than that, you know, 40 gig ZR is the only solution and easy to use. Now, switching over to ZR and ZR Plus, which is, of course, has gotten perhaps the most interest of any new technology in the last many years here. The really great thing here is that for the first time in history, we have a multi-vendor standard, meaning there's 5 DSP designs and over a dozen module designs from different vendors using different lasers that all are expected to fully interoperate between the vendors. And multi-vendor interoperability means lower cost. You know, it's obvious that if multiple vendors competing for these plugs, the cost is going to be a lot lower than if it's a single vendor and you're locked into one vendor. The other great thing here is that it's the same small pluggable form factor, either OSFP or QSFP-DD, as the client optics, which means on any router, we don't have to build special line cards, special configurations for routers and switches. Any port that supports a client optics can also support the DWM optics. The optics will have a fairly low power consumption, less than 20 watts for the ZR, maybe a little more than 20 watts for the ZR Plus, but it's around 20 watts, which still fits in this form factor. And best of all, of course, compared to legacy, revolutionary price performance, roughly 1/10 of previous costs for optical shelves with optical transponders and so on. Now, the other thing this enables, and this is getting us at least even more excited, is it enables to completely obsolete the optical shelf and run the IP traffic directly over these optical ports. And, you know, this idea has been around for at least 20 years, but it never took off because historically, if you built special line cards for the router, you know, you had a fraction of the density of the client ports and it just wasn't very attractive. With 400 gig ZR and ZR Plus, because it's the same form factor as the client optics, this solution finally works, which is, you know, you can mix and match the ports on any router. We don't have to build special cards and it comes out, you know, DWM right out of the box. And again, this is a significant cost reduction compared to legacy external optical kind of transmission equipment. And this has led some analysts, this is a guy called Andrew Schmidt from a company called Singlai, to claim this is the revolution or transformation of the real market by 2024. We actually believe this, meaning it will completely replace most other solutions in this time frame. Not the, you know, the submarine cables. I mean, there's other markets that require very specialized equipment, but all the high volume use cases, DCI, metro interconnect, will be targeted by this technology. And of course, the installed base of traditional long haul optics doesn't go bad. It will continue to operate, but this is just a lot more cost effective. Now, so what I wanted to update you first is the exact status of these modules. We got the very, very first modules in January this year. We plugged them in and the link came right up. It was actually amazing. It was like there was nothing to configure. They actually worked. Now, this was the same vendor talking to the same vendor. It took, unfortunately, another 8 months for 3 vendors to talk to each other. So there was a lot of firmware, you know, linking up configuration issues that had to be debugged between those different vendors. But as of now, all the vendors, all the well-known vendors that are that have a DSP out are talking to each other. So that's very good news. And unfortunately, will take probably another 3 months for these volume, for these modules to become more available to customers. So we're talking some samples very end of this year, but more of them and really volume in Q1 this year, next year. And the mainstream focus has been, of course, on the DCI use case, which is projected to have the highest volume. So this is the application code 0x01, which is the 80 to call it 120 kilometer external amplification high volume DCI use case. There are other modules coming, including the application code 0x02, which is the a gray optics version, which is basically not tunable, single 400 gig lambda, same DSP chip, but a different higher output power. So you can actually do 40 kilometer point-to-point link without external amplification. Those will be also available by, call it, middle of next year. And then the one that gets the most interest in the industry, which is 400 gig CR plus, which depending on the vendor and depending on the fiber quality and depending on the laser quality may reach 1,000 kilometers, but it's better to call it 300 to 600 kilometer, basically a traditional metro reach distance, but covering a lot of use cases in the service provider environment. And there is now a agreed upon spec known as Open CR Plus, which is interoperable between two out of the three DSP vendors, and the third one is basically revving the chip to meet it as well. So all of these chips, again, will talk to each other, and it's going to be a multi-vendor standard as well. Now, there is a little confusion in the market about application code 01 and 02, because people heard you can plug these things in, they talk to each other, but that's only true for the gray optics, you know, the 02 module, which is not the same module as the high volume DCI data center interconnect module. In the data center interconnect module, there is not much of optical amplification, if anything. So the minimum output power is minus 10 dB and the max is like minus 6. And the reason for that was that Microsoft wanted the highest reliability on these modules, and adding an amplifier inside the module would not have increased the reliability of the module itself. They want to do the amplification externally, but it means you need an external amp to have a DCI link. The O2 module changed the maximum output power to 0 dB and has a much higher receiver sensitivity. So that has a much better link budget. And the result is you can actually go 40 kilometer with 0.25 dB per kilometer. I think it will be popular, but it does overlap with the 400 gig ER module, ER4 module we talked about earlier in this use case. Now that CR plus, I'm sorry, so the focus here is to get the CR into production because it's the biggest market opportunity. The next biggest focus is to qualify the CR plus interoperability. So that's work in progress. It is currently believed that the two out of the three silicon chips will work in this mode and are capable, but it's still to be validated. And then the gray optics will be there as well. Now the CR plus status is that people are working on this, projected availability to customers second half 2021. And then there is already a roadmap to 800 gig CR. So since the chip designers have finished their 400 gig CR chip, then are working on the 5 nanometer 800 gig CR chip. The current focus is to keep the same coding. So it's going to be 16 QAM. You have to double the baud rate, of course. So it's going to be 120 gigabaud. And it also doubles the spectrum. So you don't actually get more bits per fiber, but it will lower the COGS because you can do it with half the modules. So the belief is that the cost per bit will be roughly half of the 400 gig modules if you use it in 800 gig mode. The same module will also support 400 gig CR backwards interoperability modes. And because it's 5 nanometer, it's going to be lower power consumption than the existing 7 nanometer 400 gig modules, the first generation modules. So one reason people are so busily working on this DSP already is to get the power down on the existing modules as well. And it is believed the first samples of these will be out in 22. and perhaps even in production 22. So again, this is a high focus for the vendors to get the power down and to add another mode, which is essentially the 800 gig ZR mode, and improve the OSNR performance as well. In conclusion here, we as a company will support all the various DSP vendors that our customers want to qualify. So we're actually very busy already doing this qualification. We're supporting both OSFP and DD form factors, of course. The our operating system will support the IP over DWM with a full set of monitoring functions and OpenConfig and Google RPC and so on. And that all is actually already in lab trials around the country. But the bottom line is we do believe the analyst forecasts will transform the transport market that will never be the same. Now I need to cover one more topic here, which is the optical line systems for both 800, 400 gig ZR and ZR plus. And the one thing to realize here is that the ZR, ZR plus standard has very low output power compared to traditional transponders. And it also needs a 75 gigahertz channel spacing because it's 16 QAM. So for all of these reasons, it doesn't particularly work well with existing install base, what we call brownfield optical line systems, because they were optimized for transponders with different characteristics. And deploying 400 gig ZR with existing brownfield optical line system is not in the scope of the standard, in blunt words. So that's sort of the background here. Now, there are some fixes coming up. So one type of module, they don't have a name yet, but for short, I'm calling it the enhanced 400 gig ZR plus module, which I would expect to be out also in a year. They will simply have higher output power, 0 dB minimum and so on, and improved other specs that it's more compatible with a brownfield optical line system. So if you have a supplier of optical line system that will support these modules in a year from now, it will actually plug right in. These same kind of modules will also support 200 gig modes to fit into 50 gigahertz grids that are more common in legacy systems, but obviously only get 200 gig in that particular mode. But the switch router will easily support that. And that should also go easily more than 1,000 kilometers. And there may be other enhanced FEC modes coming to increase the reach as well. So these enhanced parts are not quite fully standardized or spec'd out yet, but people have realized there's a market opportunity to define a SKU that will work with an existing optical line system. But the primary use case, of course, for 400 gig ZR is simply DCI, meaning 80 to 100 kilometer data center interconnect. And quite frankly, the traditional, you know, full featured optical line system, ROADM, et cetera, are just overkill for this use case. This is going from point A to point B, you know, and the legacy systems do take a lot of rack space, power, cost, and so on. So what we came up with is a much, much simpler solution for this DCI use case, something that anybody can plug in. And this is the Arista optical line system in an OSFP form factor. So we collapsed the entire amplifier, the duplex amplifier, and the colorless mux down to one OSFP. The way this works is it needs one port on the switch router. Today, you would actually lose a router port, but on future systems, we'll add dedicated optical line system ports so that you don't lose the network-facing ports. And you plug this thing in, you turn the equipment on, and it auto-configures, and it just works. So all the configuration is done as part of EOS operating system. It detects, you know, the linked instances, and it tunes the amplifier, and so on. So this is we think it's kind of a breakthrough in terms of ease of use. We're also working on one that will have 16 channels as well, in addition to the 8-channel version, which is out now. So basically what this does is it combines a colorless mux with a duplex amplifier, and it puts all of this in this very small form factor. To summarize this, you know, again, you you don't want to use 400 gig ZR with brownfield optical line systems. It's just not really spec'd out very well. But there will be enhanced versions coming in a year that will work with that if you get the support of your existing optical line system vendors. And we are offering these you know, brand new, which we call, you know, OLS modules in the OSFP form factor that will work with vanilla, the regular 400 gig ZR. And I think I'm getting actually close to my final slide here. So to sum this all up, you know, this is an exciting time. On the routing side, which we didn't really talk about, compared to the legacy routers, you know, the Juniper MX, the Cisco CRS and so on, the merchant silicon routers are an order of magnitude lower cost per port than the legacy routers. And on the optical side, you know, compared to legacy DWDM, separate optical line system shelves and so on, the ZR modules are, again, an order of magnitude lower cost. And so this is the only time in history you're going to get a 10x cost reduction in one generation. This will never happen again. But it's great news, of course, for search providers that have to amortize the cost of the equipment over the bandwidth they're selling. Now, there's some other benefits. 400 gig pipes are actually much easier to manage than the equivalent number of smaller pipes, because you know, whatever elephant flows or other things people do, it's just easier to have bigger pipes. And of course, they are fundamentally lower cost than the existing smaller pipes as well. So last slide here is, you know, these things will be in field trials late this year and in production in the first half of 21 for the DCI use case and second half 21 for the longer reach ZR plus use cases. But it's the biggest change in network cost performance in the last, I don't know, 40 years, in my opinion. And that, I think, was my last slide. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Andreas. That was an amazing presentation, and it's great to having you today. I got a few questions from the audience, and I'm going to read them out. So the first question here is from Stefan Wahl, and he's asking, more density normally means more power consumption, and as CMOS has a linear relationship, how to handle it in the near future? Lower voltage normally means smaller gates on the CMOS transistors, and that means less number of electrons are used to switch. Where is the limit here?
Yeah, so that's a very, very good question, and I'm going to go back to this one slide at the very beginning. And quite frankly, this is one reason that people have had trouble deploying 400 gig today, which is the power per port for 400 gig port today is of course significantly higher than 100 gig port today. And we are, wait 1 second here, skipped over this one slide, I need it. So to get the power down, we need more advanced process technology. In particular, the 7 nanometer technology makes it kind of attractive from a power standpoint, and 5 nanometer will be even better. But a lot of even the large cloud titans are waiting for these 7 nanometer chips before they will deploy 400 gig in volume for all of these routing use cases, because quite frankly, the power of the first generation was too high. So there's a significant power reduction between this chip in 6 nanometer and the 7 nanometer chip, almost a factor of 2. And that actually makes it more viable, but it's still higher power than 100 gig port, because in the 7 nanometer, you can support the equivalent of 400 gig, so that power is going down as well. So 400 gig is always higher power than 100 gig, but from an absolute standpoint, it's becoming attractive, I would say, in the 7 nanometer generation with the 7 nanometer DSP optics. So compared to legacy, it's a lot lower power. But if you're power constrained in your data center environment or the rack or whatever you have, it may limit how many ports you can support.
Okay, great. Thank you, Andy. The next question is also from Stefan, and he would like to know, how big is the yield per wafer in 7 nanometer and 5 nanometer?
Oh, that I cannot tell you, but I can tell you what TSMC told us about the cost per function. And the simple answer was If you make the same chip in 6 nanometer and 7 and 5, so the chip actually gets smaller, but the cost per chip, what they will charge you, does not go down. It will actually go up. In other words, it's actually more expensive to make the 7 nanometer chip of the same function, but the advantage is it's lower power and it's lower, the ability to put more transistors on. So people will still go, of course, to the more advanced technology, but the transistors are not really getting cheaper anymore. And the reason is there's only, you know, these two companies that have the process technology, and they're putting like $15 billion into each new fab. And it's so expensive, and there's so much demand, you know, from particularly from the smartphone industry that wants the longest power, the least power consumption to magnify the battery lifetime, that everybody has to go to 5 nanometer. But the biggest consumer is actually smartphones right now. So while we may be riding the curve here, there's, you know, the wafer cost on 5 nanometer is much higher than 7 or 16.
Okay, thank you. The next question is anonymous. It says, future of co-packaged optics versus regular pluggables.
Yeah, so there's a lot of interest in co-packaging under the belief that you kind of had to do it to do like the 51-point terabit chip. But the truth is you don't have to do it for the 51-point terabit chip. It fits just fine with the regular pluggables. And the trade-off, quite frankly, is serviceability. So in a, as you know, optics modules fail at a certain rate, and it's the permitted the lasers that fail, but there's also contamination with dust and so on. So the field experience we have with optics modules, 4-channel, 8-channel modules, it's mostly 4-channel modules, is in the 5 to 10 million hours per module, call it 10 million hours per module. But if you have 64 modules and you divide, 10 million by 64, and you have many of these switches, you have a lot of modules failing very quickly. Whereas the switch itself is actually pretty reliable. It's in the sort of million hour range without the optics. So what you don't want to do is to lower the reliability of the switch and you have to rip it out because one laser failed, right? So that would be a very, very bad trade-off. And in my mind, it is crazy to trade off serviceability of optics modules with the hope to save some power to integrate these optics modules on the switch chip itself. So the summary, at least from my view, is that until the reliability of these optics is demonstrably much, much higher than it is today, so they don't fail at the rate that they would impact the system level, co-packaging is actually not practical just for reliability reasons. But if it's possible to increase the optics reliability by, say, an order of magnitude, which would be highly desirable, from any perspective, then it becomes viable. So it needs basically a significant increase in reliability to avoid, having to rip out the whole box if one of the optics fails that's hidden inside the box.
Okay, great. Thanks for answering this one. The next one is from Sebastian Schrader, and he would like to know, is the interface to configure multi-speed optics standardized or proprietary?
Well, it's software. So the Cheshire chip, you can select each port to be, 400 gig, 200 gig, 100 gig. It changes from PAM4 coding to NRZ and so on. So the switch chip always was able to multi-speed. The problem was the optics module. The first generation, nobody asked the customer what they really wanted. So they just built the speed locked 400 gig gearbox. And the very first question they came up with customers, this was 18 months ago, was, well, why can't they run at half the speed if I want to talk to 200 gig or quarter speed if I want to 100 gig? Because the wavelength plan is the same, right? So 400 gig FF4 has the same wavelength CWM grid as 100 gig CWM4. So after that mistake, the new gearboxes were shown 7 nanometer process. They put in the multi-speed mode so that when you configure the speed on the CLI, you can actually select the port speed and you just can dial it down to 100 gig port from 400 gig and it will interoperate with 100 gig CWM4 optics.
Okay, thank you. So next question.
If you could add one thing, so it's not auto-configuring, right? So it's not. There's no IEEE standard that it will recognize on the optical link what it is. You have to actually dial it in on the CLI. it has to be manually configured, but it normally doesn't change unless the other side, you know, upgrades to the higher speed.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is from Gordon Guidofalvi. Regarding physical transceiver formats, what's the story with QSFP-DD versus OSFP?
Yeah, that's a good question. So OSFP is actually the highest volume right now because Google started shipping it in late 2018 and has now an installed base of several million units, which is more than the installed base of DD. And DD, on the other hand, has more vendor support from more companies, including Cisco, of course. So we support both. I mean, this is not a religious issue to us, but from a purely sort of a factual standpoint, the thermal performance of OSFP is significantly better than DD. And what we have measured is about a 1 degree per watt power consumption difference in the temperature of the module. So for say a 400 gig FR4 module today, that is say 12 watts first generation. In an apple to apple system, you know, we make both kinds of systems, and with actual modules, the and at the same, you know, environmental temperature, fan setting, and so on, the DD module ran 12 degree hotter. And for CR modules, it's actually more like 15 to 70 degree hotter. The problem with that is that 15 to 70 degree temperature difference more than doubles the failure rate of the module. So it's the module failure rate is highly related to temperature. So what we can say for sure is that the DD modules will, the optical modules, everything else being equal, will fail at twice the rate in the field than OSFP modules, which to me is a very poor trade-off to make because the optics already have the lowest MTBF in the whole system, and you really don't want your very expensive CR modules to fail. But nevertheless, you know, a lot of customers like CR because it has more vendor support. For Ethernet gig modules, the power also goes up. So the initial Ethernet gig optics will be roughly the same power as a CR module, sort of in the 18 watt level. And again, this will be, there will be OSFP DD QSFP DD versions of these as well. But they're again pushing the thermal capability of the DD in a way that's not desirable. So, and for 800 gig CR plus, the projected power is in the 24 watt range, which we know we can handle in OSFP, but we don't really believe that's practical on DD. So the thermal is just a lot better on the OSFP. I think that's the bottom line. The electrical is better as well. So for copper cables, which we didn't talk about, we get more reach. There is some early studies. The OSFP consortium started had a study group now on 1.6 terabit module using 8 channels of 200 gig electrical. And the initial simulations look actually quite promising. So it's obviously premature to say this is working in the lab because it's not yet in the lab. But it looks like there will be a 1600 gigabit OSFP module in 2024. And we don't think that will work electrically on the DD connector. The connector is too complex.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is from Blake Willis. What is the dispersion limited distance of single lane gray / CVD M100 gig ER?
Yeah, that's a very, very good question. So the presentations from the 100 gig lambda is that beyond 20, 30, somewhere between 20 and 40 kilometers, depending on your fiber and so on, it becomes a problem. So 20 kilometer is 100% safe. 30 kilometer may become the nominal spec, and on a good fiber, you get 40. But again, it depends also on the final grid. So the current proposal is 400 gigahertz grid. And that's there's a presentation at the 100 gig lambda that is, I think, is public. That has a beautiful chart that I was going to include here, but I ran out of time making slides just last night. So it's somewhere between 30 and 40 kilometer. So it will not do 80 kilometer. For example, 100 gig ER4, which is 4 by 25 gig NRZ today, is actually available as an 80 kilometer reach. That will not be possible in 100 gig ER because the dispersion quadruples when you double the bandwidth.
Okay, great, thank you. Next question is again from Stefan. If more ports are possible on each chip, how to increase port density in one rack unit?
Well, that's why, you know, Ethernet Geek is so attractive. The first Ethernet Geek system we'll have is with a 25.6T chip next year, which is just a 1U box with 32 plugs, right? And it's 25.6 terabits in 1U. The only thing that goes higher than that will be the 200 gig service. So 25.6 terabits in a 1U and you're 40 in a rack, you know, would be one petabit per rack. It's an incredible density. So it's really, I don't know, hard to argue that's not enough for a while. With co-packaging, the theory is that, you know, you could do even denser, but you're thermally limited. So the total power consumption for this 1U switch is about 1200 watts. And, you know, that's kind of the limit you can do with normal airflow in a 1U box. If you go denser, then you take so much airflow that you take the air away from other equipment in the rack, and that's not good for existing equipment. So it's ultimately a power limit of the power consumption for these chips. But 25.6T per 1U will be a very good number for the next many years.
Okay, great. So we have the last question now, which is actually a pretty good one also from Stefan. Will server infrastructure catch up soon? Line speed of 400G would be a statement.
Well, the PCI, you know, got stuck at PCI Gen 3 until literally this year, where I have to go back to services here, where Intel announced they do one version PCI Gen 4 and they're going to go straight to PCI Gen 5. But the point of this is with PCI Gen 4, you can actually support 100 gigabit NICs fairly efficiently. And the new server chips from AMD and Intel, which will have 64 cores, can easily support dual 100 gigabit uplinks. And for certain use cases, would benefit from that. So our model, the most common NIC in the industry today is a dual 25 gig NIC. And you know, either use one link or two links, which is a total of 50 gigabit. But over the next 2 years, we believe people will deploy a lot of 100 gig NICs just because it's improves your overall throughput of the whole application. And it's going to be quite cost effective. Now, in theory, you know, you could, some of these server chips could actually handle a 400 gig NIC. But the problem with that is that the use cases are so narrow that, you know, it may be some flash storage server or some AI chip. I mean, for AI chips, it's a separate category. But for normal Intel chips, you know, I think dual 100 gigabit is a lot of throughput. Normally, the throughput goes up linearly with the number of cores. So as they're going from, you know, 16, 32 to 64 cores, the I/O configuration tracks that. So that would imply you're going from 25 gig to 100 gig times two NIC.
Okay, great. Thank you, Andreas.
Okay, well, thank you for your attention. Hope this was interesting and hope to talk to you soon.
Yes, we're glad to having you as a speaker at this year's DENO conference. Thank you very much again. And with this, I will hand over to Patrick now for the closing of the conference. Thank you, Andreas.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.